So I was just enjoying, I don't know if you guys saw, I retweeted it. I found this really funny. It was a tweet. It was like some picture that some like Hillary dead ender tweeted. And it was like a picture of Hillary Clinton in Puerto Rico at some sort of Clinton Foundation event.
Oh, yeah.
And she was holding a baby. And I mean, the replies were just fantastic because every single, like half of the replies were like, now this is what a president looks like. You know, always my madam president, hashtag still with her. Oh. And then the other half of the replies were like, get that woman away from that baby. it was just no in between. It was one extreme or the other. It was so funny.
I don't know who is the person who is credited with making this one particular image that I loved. It kind of remind me of the D's guy I sent you, Chris. Remember when we were like looking at some of those?
Wait, what?
But
the D's guy.
That like D's, the weird like conspiracy guy who turned Trump guy, and he does those like photorealistic drawings.
Yeah.
With like, you know, a syringe going into like an exposed child's like brain, right, with like the skull cracked open.
Oh, is that the thing you made me look at for like half an hour?
Yeah. but there was an image, I'm not sure if it was one of his, there was an image like that that circulated around the primary last time where it was like, or the election rather, in 2016, where it was like, it's like Donald Trump, and he's like running through like a river of sewage, and he's like holding two like children, two toddlers in his arms.
Oh yes, dude.
And he's like holding them like, you know, like scared and like trying to basically get them away from a giant like Hillary.
Oh, I know exactly
demon. You know what I'm talking about?
You know the picture you're talking about. It's so good.
I love that picture. Yikes. Love that picture. But no, it's fantastic.
But also, so that picture, that Photoshop of Trump holding the two infants, like before the picture that you're talking about, you know, existed. Like where I originally saw that picture of Trump was in the aftermath of, this is gonna make me sound really stupid, I can't, what was the first big hurricane that hit the United States like during his administration?
Hurricane Harvey.
It was still on Facebook at the time, and there was this picture that circulated, and it was that picture, and it was of Trump like wading through like the waist deep water carrying an infant under each arm, and like people were circulating this picture, some of whom literally believed that this was an actual picture of Trump like rescuing children from the hurricane.
He can't even drive a car.
Jesus Christ.
The Redneck Navy. Remember that?
No.
Was that
what?
The Redneck Navy. That it was like basically, you know, the, you know, used car dealership owners in Houston that had boats, you know, like fishing boats and shit.
Oh, sure.
That like went to, you know, flooded developments and shit and helped people get to safety or whatever. And he touted that. He was like, the Redneck Navy went above and beyond when nobody else would be there for them.
You sound like a drunk Trump. I love that.
I've been experimenting with my Trump voice because I think it's actually, I kind of like the one where he's a bit more soothing.
Donald Trump ASMR.
I was in D.C. this weekend, and we were walking along the mall, and I just, like, over and over, just annoying my family to the most, being like, America will never be a socialist country. And I just kept saying it over and over, and it's like, kind of like a mantra, I suppose, but it was very like soothing in a way. It was just extremely funny to me because he's said it now a few State of the Unions in a row, and like obviously whatever, this is the whole thing that's occupying his brain because he's like, oh shit, America might be a socialist country. I think is what he's really saying.
What I was just before we started recording, when I was like saying in my head in Trump voice over and over again and having a lot of fun with, was I found this video just a little bit ago on Twitter of like, it was from a Trump rally, and it was like these two guys in like QAnon shirts and like militia type patches and stuff, and they were like carrying this like just ancient old man like through the crowd, and like the whole crowd was shouting like USA, USA, and it was weird. It like had this like what I was imagining, them like carrying him like to the stage, like to an altar to be sacrificed, and like Trump like we're gonna do it, folks. We're gonna summon them. We're gonna summon Moloch, folks. I was having a lot of fun imagining that situation. Like Trump
It's just right before the president like cuts, you know, into his chest and pulls out a still beating heart. The guy's just like, thank you, Mr.
Thank you,
president.
Sir. Thank you, sir.
He's like, you got to do it. You got to, you know, it's got to happen.
Dark ritual.
Folks, we're going to bring it back. People have you seen Apocalypto, folks? You seen Apocalypto? They took him to the top of the ziggurat. The top of the ziggurat, folks. They took his heart out. And they pushed him down.
Like, and what would it even take for Trump to lose evangelical Christians? Like, literally, if during a rally he started, like, attempting to summon Moloch.
I don't think there's anything that he could do.
Would that do it? I'm not even sure.
No.
There's literally nothing.
You know,
literally nothing.
To that, you know, I was reading this book that is not particularly great. I don't want to be too ungenerous to it, but I was reading this book that was, like, one of these... kind of like liberal, what do you call them? Like a sort of like liberal ethnography where like these people from like a university go somewhere into like the deep south or into the Midwest and they like talk to conservative people for the
God,
first time. And they're like, oh my God, like the people here, they eat food and drink water just like I do. And it was mostly kind of bullshit. But the one thing that I found that was interesting that what you were saying just made me think of, and I think I showed this to you, Cari, but like there was this one couple who, because they were talking to a bunch of people who was in Louisiana who had been like affected by a bunch of chemical spills and stuff, and who were like vaguely environmentalists and hated the companies that were responsible for it or whatever, and they knew that like the Republicans were going to side with those companies, but they said they voted for them anyway, and their reasoning for voting for like Mitt Romney was like, well, he's definitely going to side with these, you know, these chemical companies, he's not going to help us out, but he is like anti-abortion, and that's more important because, like, you know, the environment and Earth is, you know, I'm already like 70. I'm gonna be dead soon, and the Earth isn't gonna last forever, but heaven lasts forever. And so when I die, like, and the phrase that the guy used was like, I'm thinking long term about this.
Sure,
you know, like I'm playing the long game here because, you know, I'm growing a second head out of my neck because I'm like breathing in these carcinogens fucking fumes and, you know, drinking tainted water for 20 years, but like I'm gonna save hundreds of billions of babies' lives and prevent
and
them from being genocided by, you know, the, you know,
Hillary Clinton.
That's right.
Yeah, thinking long term.
There's a lot to unpack there.
Absolutely. So I'm watching, I've got, actually, for those listening to this, you know, out of our love for you, the listener, we're actually, we're foregoing watching the debate, which I think we would all be enjoying right now. But I got the debate on, and I thought that Bloomberg wasn't going to get a box to stand on, but he definitely seems not as short as he is. I'm not sure what's going on here.
Hey, Chris, do you have the link to that illegal stream? Can you send it to me so I can watch it too?
Oh, I'm
in the background.
The legal stream that we pay for? Is that what you meant? I think you misspoke.
I can't tell. I think they're being very generous with the camera angles. Like every time they show Bloomberg, it's very funny. But he's getting a lot of screen time here.
Worker, por favor, arriba con el camera, porque yo estoy un poquito cortado.
Are you really sending? Do you really have the illegal stream?
No. We're all waiting for it.
Yeah, you got that link, bro?
Just dead silence.
No, I'm watching it on my my antenna TV that you were just fucking roasting me for before we started watching.
Why are you roasting me for that? That's totally reasonable.
Thank you.
I'm not trying. Well, I was under the impression that the FCC had reclaimed and auctioned off those wavelengths. I didn't think that you could broadcast anything over an antenna anymore.
No, you use a digital antenna. That's like the new standard.
Oh, folks, we're learning something every day.
Buttigieg looks like he skipped shaving today, which is an interesting choice.
No, I was just going to say, I've seen a number of people make this connection already on Twitter, and it was one of the first things I thought when the good mayor, Pete, got into the race. There's a character in Warren Ellis's graphic novel series, Trans Metropolitan, called the Smiler, who is a like totally PR crafted political candidate for president, and the, you know, the, I'm not gonna get into it, whatever, it's a good,
you brought us here,
you started
far.
It
Carrie has 36% left on her battery. We need to hear it.
Yeah, please.
No, I mean, I don't, like, it's been years and years since I read them. Just the whole idea is because, like, the other president, I think this was written in the 90s, and so the incumbent president is, I think, supposed to be, like, an amalgamation of, like, Clinton and Nixon and all these, like, deeply, deeply corrupt kind of establishment people, and then here's this, like, new guy who's, like, a lot younger, and he's all, you know, he's very, like, PR spiffy, and he's always smiling, which is where he gets the nickname the Smiler, and he uncannily looks very similar to Pete Buttigieg, which is why people have like posted pictures of them side by side, especially when if you get a picture of him smiling. And I mean, in the actual graphic novel, I mean, I also don't want to spoil it, but he wins the election and he becomes like he's like a deeply evil authoritarian person, even though he was all like smiley when he was coming to the thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think we can readily internalize that by now.
Yeah, there's no like political depth to the cartoon or my thought.
Or Pete Buttigieg. There's no fucking political depth in him either. No ideological depth. No fucking nothing. Just created in a fucking lab.
I tweeted this like, I don't know, a couple weeks ago. Who knows? Everything feels like a million years every 24-hour cycle. But like, I was thinking about that, you know, his phrase of Medicare for all who want it. It's such a ridiculous premise, because if you applied that to any other like generalizable service, right, that like we already have, it would be absurd. Like roads for everybody who wants it, you know, like fire departments for everybody who wants it.
Yes.
You know, like the you can obviously take that in a variety of ways, you know, civil defense for all who want it. Like, it's just such a stupid fucking idea. Like, then why does the government do anything? Like, why?
Exactly.
Like, you know, like, food safety regulations for all who want it. Water standards for all who want it. Like, there's a reason why there are, like, as a social group, we come together and we agree that these things are, like, good for the society as a whole. Vaccines for all who want it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what?
We've done a bad job of, like, the left hasn't had a platform because it's been, like, actively squashed for the last, like, 60 years or whatever. But, like, it just shows you, like, how right-leaning the Democrats are, because like we should be doing a better job of propaganda. Be like, hey, you know, I said this on the I think like on an episode or two ago, and I've been thinking about it since then, which is I was like, you know, clean water is an enormous achievement
for all who want it.
Yeah.
but and then you can't take away Americans' power of choice, Dwight.
But like, I was thinking about like Flint, Michigan. There is no clean water there. Parts of Newark, New Jersey, there's no clean water there. But it is expressly in those like liberal institutions that have failed us and are continuing to fail us that we find those problems. But like, we should be better at propaganda like that. Like, wouldn't it be fucking absurd if we lived in a world where we just like stopped funding the interstate highway system and you would just like fall off a bridge when you're traveling from fucking Columbus to like Lexington, Kentucky?
Don't give them any ideas.
Oh, God. So, our guest this week, I think, Cari, this is your third appearance on the show, isn't it? Coming to us live from fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada.
Yeah, from the Days in Las Vegas, Nevada.
Hell yeah.
The fabulous Wild Wild West Days in.
Vegas is cool, man. Like, I got a chance, the one time I've ever been there, to, like, hang out with somebody that lives in Vegas and, like, go to see the actual downtown and, like, the cool art shit communities and stuff that's going on there. Like, it's an actually really cool city. I dig Las Vegas.
Yeah, it's a great city. This is like my fourth time here. Like, I've been here to go hiking and stuff a bunch of times. I've never gambled here still, and Shane is insisting that I play roulette, which I'm not gonna do.
Oh, you gotta play roulette once, man. I've only gambled like a handful of times in like the Caribbean.
Oh, I love gambling rules, dude.
It's so good. I only spent like $50 and like across like the two or three times that I've actually been into a casino. And the reason why is like the very first time I like went into, I was in Puerto Rico and I went to like, they had like a roulette table and I was like, oh hell yeah, I want to play roulette. And I played some roulette for a little while. I was up for like a minute, you know, a few dollars, and then I lost like whatever the $25 I'd put in. I said, okay, no big deal. I went downstairs and the like configuration of the hotel was like, the hotel bar was right near an escalator that then took you directly into the casino. So when you left the casino, you went straight to the bar. And I sat down there and I ordered a drink, and I was sitting there and I could feel on the back of my neck, like a pull, like a line pulling me back to the roulette table. Dude. Like, come on, baby, just like you did a couple more times. You could definitely go up. You could definitely go up. And I was like, you know what? I am gonna go back. So I did. I lost another $20. And then I was like, this probably is dangerous for me personally.
Oh yeah,
but it's great. I fully
and
advocate.
That's what you want
there
me
is
to
no.
Do.
Let me tell you. There was one time I took a trip to Atlantic City with a buddy of mine when I was still living in Virginia. I drove up. I was seeing some concerts. I was seeing Further, which is like an offshoot of the Grateful Dead. I was like doing their concert tour, summer tour, or whatever. And the last night was in Atlantic City, and like I met my buddy there. We had a hotel room. We went to the concert, and then like we went back to the casino and kept gambling and stuff. And then like I was up like $600, right? And then like the
oh nice.
Well, it's not the end of the story.
You could just stop telling it there, and we'll all be really impressed.
No, but then the next day, like we checked out of the hotel, and then like he left, and I was like, all right, I'm just gonna go back to the casino just for
real quick
before I leave town, and then like you know 3 o'clock in the morning, like the next day, I'm still sitting in there, and I'm like,
oh no,
I've lost the $600 I was up. I've almost completely lost the $500 that I allotted myself to gamble with.
Oh no.
And I was like, all right, I had like $20 left or something. I was like, I just got to put it all on one number. I put it on like, you know, fucking 17 or whatever, some whatever random number. Like, I got to put it all on this one number, and I got like a 1 in 32 or 1 in 34 chance of whatever of hitting it. And then everything will be fine, right? And then like, of course I lost. And then let me tell you, there's no emptier feeling than leaving Atlantic City at 3 a.m. and then driving silently by myself like 5 or 6 hours home to Virginia. Like having just been up $600, you know, 12 hours before, and now I'm, you know, lost $500. So Cari, that's what we're all encouraging you to do.
Yeah, it's good. It's
cool,
good.
Yeah.
I mean, there's something like, you know, obviously gambling is something that existed for a very long time and across a variety of different cultures and in different forms, but there is something like very American to the way that casinos are designed in Atlantic City and Las Vegas. I mean, obviously all the like knick-knack shit there, like you're in the Wild Wild West one or whatever. But like, there's something, I don't know, I know that this isn't good, but there's something in me, like some deeply, deeply buried, vaguely, you know, like national nostalgia. Where
oh, sure.
Like, yeah, man, like you could win, you know, like you could be a winner. Like I'll be up on the up and up again. Trust me, I just need $5 more. I got this. Don't worry.
I think you have a gambling problem.
Desperate. Yeah, man. You might be a dry gambler.
Yeah. Oh yeah, well, I will get, you know, addicted obviously to absolutely anything possible. I don't know if you guys remember, like when we first started, when we first all got thrown in that group chat together, when we first all met, like a little over a year ago now. Like the last house I was living at, I don't know if you remember, but like I went through a little period there with my roommates where I was like, I was shooting dice all the time. I was playing CeeLo. Do you remember that? I would like send pictures.
No.
Like, send pictures.
I remember that, yeah.
Like every single night I was fucking like shooting dice with my roommates. It was awesome. Like in the basement, like on a fucking like hard concrete floor, like on a piece of cardboard. It ruled, dude.
What the fuck, man? What the fuck?
Just pure luck. Just the worst type of gambling you can do. Like no skill at all. Just purely luck.
Were you betting like dimes or something?
Oh no. I mean, typically I think we'd bet like start off like a minimum of like 50 cents a roll or like a dollar a roll, but like sometimes like, you know, someone would get down and like there'd be times where, you know, people be trying to double up, triple up, get their money back. We'd be doing like $5 a roll, $10 a roll, $20 a roll. Like people, there was some large chunks of money that exchanged hands.
So anyway, if you're listening to this, it's because you subscribe to the Patreon. So thank you for supporting the show. This money will not, I guarantee, will not go directly to a couple of bus tickets and a night at the Bellagio. Do not worry, dear listener. We would never do that.
Oh my God.
No. Thank you, Patreon subscribers, to fucking just get a hot hand of dice with that money.
When I was a young boy, about the age of 5, my teachers taught me I could be the greatest man alive. They told me I could change the world, be whatever I wanted to be. There's no one in the world like me. Every one of us was so unique. I'd not be an average man. No, sir, I'd be no average man. So I have those big dreams.
Welcome back, everyone, to Eat the Rich. This is a show about our political economy, late-stage capitalism, and the millionaires, billionaires, and multinational corporations hell-bent on staving off its death rattle. I'm Dwight, and today we have with us Shane.
Howdy!
Wow. Wow.
That was like a mini Pearl howdy.
I was going to do howdy because I'm at the Wild West Hotel. Now you took that away from me.
Selfish.
We've got Chris.
Yes!
We've got Chris.
Yo, yo.
And our senior political correspondent reporting from the Nevada primaries, Cari, is with us today.
Howdy.
Cari, you are... Nice. You are canvassing and volunteering with the Bernie campaign in Nevada. How's it going? Tell us what's going on.
It's going really well. I knocked on Melly, and I knocked on over 100 doors in one day. The first day we went canvassing, and it was a mostly positive experience. It was pretty cool. We only had like one weird Trump guy that was trying to like tell us to fuck off. But everybody else we interacted with was either, you know, neutral or super excited to vote for Bernie. Met a Canadian guy that said he wished he could vote for Bernie.
He can.
No voter fraud.
Well, no, that's why you're there, right? You're working for Putin.
That's right.
You're doing election meddling. You're rigging it for Bernie, correct?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Russia, if you're listening.
I am not doing election.
I was thinking about that today, Dwight. Like, man, I really, like, sincerely, Russia, if you're listening, please hack the DNC again. Like,
I am not associated.
Get those emails. I want to see what they're up to.
I am not associated with this. So speaking of, the other thing I did was I volunteered with the Nevada Democratic Party at the polls. And that was a very different experience from canvassing. There were a lot of people
What were you doing there?
I was helping people just get checked in to vote. Strip workers. I was in a casino in an early voting location. And the ballots are just really confusing. A lot of people filled them in wrong, and then we had to, like, have them redo it. A lot of people didn't speak English, and there wasn't really, like... I mean, I speak Spanish, of course, but there wasn't really, like, full support there for the amount of people that we had. And that was a little bit demoralizing, but we got as many people through as we could, and hopefully that'll make a difference. There were culinary unions. People like standing off at a distance, which I guess was like the legal distance, and that was a little weird. But
what's their I don't get, like, what's their grind though, man? Like, what is their beef?
Well, they like own a healthcare company or something, right? Like, they make money off of insuring the union members through their thing. Isn't
right
that
but
what
they,
it is?
They haven't endorsed anybody, right?
No, but they hand out a flyer.
But they like explicitly did not endorse Bernie. And it's weird. Like, I've noticed, like, I follow all the candidates on Twitter, and like all of them have been like, especially Buttigieg and I think Warren and Klobuchar have all been like tweeting about the culinary union a bunch.
Yeah, on the debate, they just spent a whole section on that. I think they might still be talking about it.
I mean, have you guys seen the flyer that they gave out?
So bad.
It lists the candidates, and it doesn't like explicitly say don't vote for Bernie, but it like presents the stuff in a way of like, you know, what's their position on healthcare, and then it says like each thing for each candidate, and then for Bernie is like would take away your private insurance or your union insurance or whatever. So it's like presenting it in such a way that it's like Bernie is bad without saying like don't vote for Bernie. It's supposed to be like an informational flyer saying like how to vote and like when to vote and stuff, but it's like very obviously biased.
No, My jaw dropped when I saw that. It was so plain.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, because they had like Medicare for All in quotes.
Right.
And you know, it was, they framed it in a way that said like, you know, if you're keeping this candidate, will keep the culinary healthcare. And then, you know, right. Bernie was taking it
Bernie's
away.
Bernie's a monster.
Like his stood out. Yeah. Yeah, that's what it made it look like.
Yeah, he was also, like, all the way at the bottom, I think. It was just, like, really obvious the way they artfully positioned framed. It.
It's so weird to me because, like, you know, anytime you hear, like, any sort of, like, you know, from the right or from big business, any sort of criticism of unions, like, anytime you see any of those, like, union busting, like, training videos that they show, like, you know, big box store employees or whatever, like, their criticism is always, like, it's like, well, you know, the union, they just want your money and they just, you know, they just operate like, you know, union is big business too. But like when I hear about something like this, like my criticism is like, this sounds like a business. Like what? Like yeah. Why are they operating in this way? Like it's demoralizing to hear of a union that doesn't really seem to be standing in solidarity with its workers.
Yeah, it's definitely not.
It sucks, man. I mean, look. Ideally, you know, we're in our new American socialism. We're moving towards an economy that's owned by the workers,
right,
and not owned by capital. And so, ideally, we wouldn't need unions, right? Because we would just have workers be the owners of the enterprises, and there wouldn't be, you know, like a hierarchical structure as far as like management goes, because it would be democratically run and you would vote on how to distribute the profits and shit. That being said, because we live under capitalism, you know, unions are our current tool to organize within the workplace. And at their best, they should really be like social justice organizations. But, you know, if there is no employee activism, it just entropy takes hold.
Sure.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right?
Absolutely.
It's just entropy takes hold. And that's, yeah, I get it. You know, especially if like you're describing, Cari, that there's a kind of like a predatory sort of thing going on for workers that may not speak English or something. You know, like that's... I don't know. It really fucking sucks.
I mean, I don't think that part was necessarily like an intentional thing. It was just like I don't know. It just feels like it's not set up for the amount of support that's needed. I don't know if that's like intentional or malicious, but it just doesn't seem like it's set up for the amount of support that's needed for Spanish speakers. I went into the field office that's near here and I was doing Spanish language calls, and there weren't really like that many Spanish speakers there to call people. Tomorrow we're going to canvass the strip, like a group of Spanish speakers are going to canvass the strip to get them to caucus. But I mean, there's just not enough people volunteering, I think, for Bernie or for the Nevada Democratic Party that speaks Spanish. I'm going to say Nevada every time, so just know that.
Well, I was just going to ask. I know that since obviously we've kept in touch and you've been telling me about some of your experiences there, I know that coming up against the deficiencies that exist, like, I think, you know, in the sort of civic democracy apparatus altogether, right? Like, there is a deficit there. There's a lack there. I mean, I've worked in the past at, like, you know, not for the party or whatever, but, like, just for, like, the city of New York to do, like, their election stuff, you know, as a one-day worker, you know, temp worker to do, like, election clerk stuff. And it's always, like, been, it was such a shock to me when I started doing that when I was, like, 18. It was just, like, wow. Like, even, like, you know, here in this, in the city, there was no infrastructure to support like the amount of people that wanted to vote, or like just, you know, had the right information. And you know, comparably across the country, like I would say New York City does a pretty good job in terms of driving turnout. So I know that has been a little disheartening, but I was wondering if you could maybe share with us and our listeners some of the more positive experiences you've had as well. Like, I don't know, in terms of just the general mood of like the campaign and the people you've met and talked to.
I volunteered at the Bernie rally yesterday at UNLV, and that was a really, really positive experience. Like, there were a bunch of volunteers there, and everybody was really excited to be there, even if, you know, their job was just to, like, count people as they came in, or, like, my job was just kind of, like, to stand around and, like, herd people toward the stage to make sure they weren't, like, forming a weird blob in the middle where people couldn't walk by. And, you know, it doesn't sound very important, but it was really exciting to be there, and everybody that works, like, on the campaign itself, you know, we met the people that are working on the Nevada campaign, and they're all just like so focused and so like they're just amazing at what they do. And it felt really good how everything, you know, kind of went off without a hitch. Everything went as planned. They got all the volunteers assigned to their roles super quickly, and it was just fucking awesome to see that. Like, it was just operating like a well-oiled machine, and, you know, all the students students then came in because, you know, it's a college, and everybody was so excited to be there. When Bernie came out, everybody was like screaming. And I've never been to a Bernie rally before. I had never seen Bernie in person before. So that's probably been like the high point for me.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah, it rules.
So good.
And then after that, we had like a march to the on-campus early voting location. Yesterday was the last day for early voting here. And there was just like such a huge line. Like the line was already coming out of the building. Somebody that was coming out told us that the line was like 2 hours, but then like more people just kept getting in line, you know? So it really felt like people were like determined to vote, and that felt good. Who was it today that said that crowds don't translate into votes?
Oh, fuck, who was that?
Was it Simone Sanders?
Oh, yeah, I don't fucking know. I saw that take.
Some dumb. I can't even like come up with something creative.
But yeah, I mean, like that was a situation where I saw the crowd turn into votes, basically. Like they were all going to the polling location, and that felt really good.
I mean, the other thing that I was curious and I would like to hear you talk a little bit about is, like, you know, I know that for you, this is, you know, your first time kind of doing this, especially like going to a whole other state to work for the campaign. And, you know, that was like a bit of a trip and a trek. And I know that, like, you know, there was some apprehension about, like, you know, the ease of doing it or getting into it. And I was just wondering if you could kind of speak about like how that worked for you, just the kind of mental space of preparing to go and thinking about going. And then when you actually got there, like, how long did it take you to feel like, oh, this is something I can do, this is something I can contribute to?
I was like really super anxious, as you know, like before I left, because I've never even canvassed before ever, and I was going to a different state to do it. But like as soon as we got to the field office the first day, they, you know, somebody immediately was like, oh, let me drive you to where you need to go. And they drove us to somebody's house. Like somebody had volunteered their house as a staging location for canvassing, and you know, he had his dogs there, and there were like a bunch of people there. There were like donuts and like drinks. And the guy who owned the house was like really, really nice. And he had somebody kind of like leading trainings, and they were like rotating people in and out. And the guy whose house it was, like as he was training me, we did like role play to like see how canvassing would go. And I think like once we did that and we were, you know, he was like kind of jokey about it and we were laughing, I started to feel really comfortable. And I was like still a little bit apprehensive, but like after we knocked on the first door, like all my anxiety just like completely went away. Like it was crazy, because I'm a super socially anxious person. I was really worried, like, am I going to be good at canvassing? Am I going to be, like, panicking the whole time? Is this going to be weird? But it was not weird at all. Like, by the time that we had our first negative interaction of the day, which I think was, like, several hours in like, the second area that we were assigned to, I was just, like, completely confident and, like, blew the guy off and was not even affected by it because I felt so good. So it ruled.
So cool. I mean, look, I've been organizing for a while, and like I just there's still like a nervousness with it, and the first time, you know, when you first encounter somebody. But like I just love that there's no doctrine to it. It's just like pick up a box and help out, and you're already part of it. Like the entry level is just, it's not low because you have to want to be there, and that's relatively difficult place to be because, you know, we're all crushed under the boot of capitalism, and it's hard to even like, you know, cope with our own selves, let alone find you know, energy to be an activist. But like, man, it's just the gratification is so good. It's so good.
Yeah, it's super rewarding.
Even, you know, just like texting for Bernie, which I've been doing as often as possible. It's a lot of fun. It's occasionally a mixed bag, but I found that overall, like the people that respond to it are just overwhelmingly positive, and it makes it feel pretty good. Especially like seeing people. I've been seeing like a lot of Bernie stickers and pins on the train and stuff like that in New York, which has been really, really positive.
Oh, dude, I was driving home this evening and I was sitting in a red light, and I noticed that the car directly in front of me had a Bernie sticker, and then the car in the next lane over in front of me also had a Bernie sticker. And I was like, oh, dude, like we're gonna win, man. It brought me such a warm feeling to see. It was so fucking cool.
I do feel that positivity.
I was sitting in my office today and I looked into my window and I saw a Bernie sign there. And I
was like, was that, did it happen to be on the inside of the window?
Perhaps. Yeah, no, it was totally on the inside of the window. By the way, maybe as a side bit, I don't know if we'll keep this in, but I have the debate now up on my other monitor here, and I'm watching.
Oh, everyone's got a legal stream but me.
But I've got it with the you know, the captions on.
Oh, I should
on,
turn the fucking right? closed captions on. I'm
and,
a moron.
And and they just had a question to Bloomberg about his tax returns, and Bloomberg's defense was, I can't release my tax returns because they'd be 1,000 pages long.
What a fucking... Oh!
Oh. What a fucking asshole. What a piece of shit, no. Dude. What a oh fucking my god. Prick. Oh my God.
You know, it's just, it's such a sign of what just a deeply, deeply diseased society this is, that like, that this fucking asshole can literally just basically put $500 million in a trash can and set it on fire, you know, and with the amount of money that I believe it's $400 million on television ads and another nearly $100 million on, you know, social media ads. And like, you can just do that and like, there's no like mass societal backlash. Like, it's just fine. And then he gets treated as like a serious candidate, and like that's just a totally okay thing for a person to do, is to just fucking set $500 million on fire.
It would be more socially productive if he took that $500 million, bought 5 F-35s, and just set those on fire. like unironically, that would be a better like overall product.
Allegedly parody, but unironically, but allegedly.
Oh, Biden just grabbed Buttigieg.
I saw that.
So I don't know what
send
the fuck
me the
happened.
Fucking illegal stream, man. Send me the
he
stream.
You should have watched the
I'm
debate.
I'm watching it on NBC.com. I'm a good boy.
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, Bernie is digging into Bloomberg. He is like fucking. He is fucking yelling.
Yeah, you're
at
a little
him,
bit
dude.
Behind me. Actually, right now they just asked Klobuchar a question about how she couldn't name the president of Mexico. That's next up.
Guys, why don't we do a little fan service and do some Curious Cat questions here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is okay. Hang on. Bomp. That's the hard.
I got it.
Very good.
I think it should just be you saying it.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, that's what it has to be.
Anyway. So we solicited everybody for some Curious Cat questions because we want to be able to have, you know, a little bit of a dialogue here. So if you guys will allow me, I'll just go through some of these things. Maybe start off with something that's maybe a little light.
All right.
Chris, this might be for you. You might know this a bit better.
Jeez.
What do you think of the Wendy's 4 for $4 meal?
Oh, the Wendy's 4 for $4? Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you what, it's a goddamn shame that they took the spicy chicken go wrap off of that. So my go-to my go-to meal at Wendy's for a while was the 4 for $4 with the spicy chicken go wrap, the McNuggets, not the McNuggets, the chicken nuggets, the French fries, and the drink or whatever.
Wait, hold on a second. Is this four items for $4 each?
No.
Or is it four
no,
items
$4
for $4?
Come on, man.
You got four items for $4 total?
Yeah.
Junior bacon cheeseburger,
I'm
baby.
I'm looking up the nearest Wendy's.
Yeah, but they took the spicy chicken go wrap off of that. And I don't always feel like a burger. I want something a little bit lighter.
That was okay.
hit me with another one.
Actually, that was actually kind of interesting the way phrasing that I said that, because somebody says, "Who's your favorite Succession character?"
Oh, I mean, Greg and Tom, obviously.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Chris, I thought you were gonna say this is my time to shine to do Kendall.
Oh well, Dwight does a fantastic Kendall impression, but the thing is, unfortunately, it's as much as it is the voice, it's a visual impression. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not gonna translate as well on the recording here. But please, by all means, take it away, Kendall Roy.
Okay, this is the Kendall Roy impression. It's pretty simple. It's more like three sounds more than anything. But he goes, Okay. Does Dad know? That's it.
Nice.
I remember you showing that to me for the first time. Remember, it was you and me and Mike and Jenna, and we were at that like the Irish famine memorial or whatever.
Yes. It's a serious memorial. No need for hilarity. It's a very good memorial, and there's no commemorating a very sad tragedy.
They have a Henry Kissinger quote on the wall. I remember noticing that. They do. They have a lot of quotes from various figures, world leaders and stuff, and one of them is Henry Kissinger.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I don't know what he had to do with the Irish family.
Famous diplomat, dignitary, Henry Kissinger.
We love him.
It was a shame that they weren't able to have enough potatoes.
All right, here's since we are doing a little fan service here, this is an interesting question. What music do y'all listen to? Any favorite albums?
Oh, you've said it all. You guys have already said all.
Shane just hates. I love how much Shane hates music that he gets defensive every time we want to talk
really
about it.
We're really picking on an insecurity
here.
He loves
music.
That we should maybe.
Cari, spill the tea. What does Shane listen to?
Shane listens to the Pirates of the Caribbean soundtrack every day.
No,
that's not a joke.
No, Shane.
He listens to Soviet Wave.
All right.
Wow.
Which is like lo-fi chill beats to study to, but Soviet.
Oh my God.
He listens to the theme for Workers and Resources Soviet Republic.
Fantastic theme. Fantastic sound.
And Rammstein. And that's it. That's
Rammstein.
All Shane listens to.
It's Rammstein.
Rammstein. And that's all Shane listens to as far as I'm aware. Mm.
There's also one Muse song I listen to occasionally.
One,
that's right.
High
there's
hopes,
the one
high
Muse
hopes.
Song.
Is it does it do the Mayor Pete dance?
No, it's Uprising by Muse.
That's right. Yikes. That's right.
It's a very
you
cool
also
song.
Listen to like Irish songs.
That's right. I listen to a lot of Irish songs, and I like to sing them as well.
That's great, man.
We sing and them drunkenly in the streets sometimes.
And if I had a piano here, like I used to have, I would play them too.
I would really. Yeah,
I had no idea you played piano.
Yeah, I play the piano and the saxophone. Detest
fuck
music. Detest music.
I used to
wait. You play
detest.
Saxophone?
I used to play the
saxophone.
Yeah, I play saxophone.
Which saxophone?
Alto.
I played alto as well. Oh, okay. All through high school.
I played tenor all through high school.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling.
I mean, yeah.
The Irish music I like to listen to and sing tends to be a little angrier than that. Although I do have the occasional sad song.
Yeah, it depends on the drunkenness level.
Dirty old town. Chris, I know you got one on the tip of your tongue. An album. I know it's...
Oh, I mean, no, I was listening to Loaded by the Velvet Underground last night. In fact, I posted about it
well.
Yeah, no, I'm really into, love the Velvet Underground. I love Lou Reed solo, like the Kinks a lot. I like a lot of like 70s, like glam rock, like proto punk type stuff. And I also like, everybody knows I like Fish and the Grateful Dead a lot and country music. Love country music. Merle Haggard and Hank Jr. and the old outlaw stuff, that type of stuff.
Toby Keith.
You know, I never got into Toby Keith. I never got into Toby Keith. I like Sturgill Simpson a lot. That's
American girl, American guy.
No, here's the thing. Like, I mean, people see me, you know, all the time retweeting like Charlie Daniels' Benghazi post and like replying to Charlie Daniels' posts and occasionally getting blocked by him and stuff. But like, I unironically love Charlie Daniels. Like, his music fucking rocks, dude. I like him a lot.
Chris, do you like Hank Williams or just Hank Williams Jr.?
Oh, I like them both. I mean, I listen to Jr. more than the father.
Have you been to the museum?
No. No, I haven't.
It's really good. It has the car that Hank Williams died in.
Okay, that rules. Hell yeah.
Yeah, it rules.
just to answer that question for myself, I'm not going to go into like favorite albums or whatever. One that has been occupying myself, that is one of my favorite albums, and no one's going to know this for the record, unless anybody's into like, you know, progressive jazz from the 1970s or whatever. But Pat Metheny Group Travels, shout out Lyle Mays, the pianist, died last week at age 66. If anybody knows him, I'm genuinely serious. DM me. Very curious to see if anybody knows that album or Lyle Mays. Very sad. This is my favorite question so far.
Okay.
It's a two-parter.
Okay.
It's a two-parter, which is, which of you is the tallest? Also, favorite hard drug rock song.
What?
I don't know.
Dave.
That's the question.
Am I the tallest? I think I'm the tallest.
I think Chris is the tallest.
Chris is taller than me. At a towering 6'6", if I'm not mistaken, because I'm 6'5".
That's right. <up. laughs>
So
I am 4 feet tall, and I don't give a shit. I do not care.
I'm also 6'5".
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You guys, Cari and Chris, tallest. Me, down
that's
an inch.
Right.
And then Shane at a respectable and yet powerful 4'6".
That's right.
You know, it was really funny.
What was the second question?
Oh, go ahead.
Well, is the second part of the question about a song you listen to while on hard drugs or a hard drug you like to enjoy while listening to songs?
I'm thinking...
Because
I'm going to
say if it's the latter, don't waste your hard drugs on music. There's a variety of activities you can be doing if you happen to encounter some recreational material.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could be in Russia and hack into the DNC. Russia, if you're listening to that guitar solo in Freebird, we're in Forrest Gump, that Jenny's going to jump off the balcony.
I guess songs about drugs, I'd say maybe top three. I like Waiting for My Man by the Velvet Underground. I like,
Oh, hell yes.
I really like a Hank Williams Jr. song called OD'd in Denver, which fucking rules.
Jesus
and then
Christ.
I like, there's a song off, I think it's off Lynyrd Skynyrd's album Second Helping. There's a song called Needle and Spoon that fucking rocks. It's one of their lesser known songs, but it's really good.
Wow.
As far as songs to like, so this is like really lame and like embarrassing, but like a couple years, like, so like I'm sober now, but like I had about 10 years ago, I had another previous like period of sobriety for a couple years. And then like when I decided to relapse, like I went and I bought a 6-pack of beer, and like the song that I picked out that I thought would be a really cool song to relapse to was the song I'm Bad, I'm Nationwide by ZZ Top. So that was the song. Yeah, that was the song I put on to drink my first beer in 3 years. Yeah.
Wow, that's quite something.
It's so stupid, dude.
Here's a good question. What are good books to get into that help develop your current understanding of today's political climate and how capitalism is a sham?
I don't read books. Don't need them.
That's a Shane question. That's for Shane. It's your time to shine.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I mean, it's hard because I've had a couple of people ask me things like this, like, and, you know, there's a huge variety of material. It depends on what you like to read. I have to read a lot for the work stuff that I do, and those tend to be a little bit more niche. And when I have time off, I like to sort of recreationally read a lot of history stuff. I think, and I've made this point, I think, before on the show when we did A Curious Cat, that, like, understanding history is, you know, really key to understanding our current moment. I'm trying to think of a specific book about, like, the economy today. I mean, on a more cultural dynamic, it's a bit old now, and some of the examples might be sort of dated, but Empire of Illusion by Chris Hedges. I read that when I was, like, in my early 20s, and it kind of blew my mind. He goes through and he does a couple of case study examples of, you know, how the sort of cultural and social dynamics of what it is to live in a sort of fading empire and, you know, society of the spectacle idea. Let me think if I can think of anything more recent. Again, that's focused on economics.
Was that the guy? Was that the guy you quoted when we had Leslie on the program?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was from that book.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
Memory, Chris.
Just curious.
Have you read Limits to Capital?
No, I actually haven't. The David Harvey book, that's been on my list for a long time.
Yeah, I started it, but I didn't finish it. But I think that one's supposed to be really good.
Yeah, I mean, the other contemporary author that's, like, explicitly a communist that I like quite a bit is Jody Dean. I think she's written, the two of her books that I like a lot are The Communist Horizon, which probably came out in the, like, early 2010s. And then she had a book called Crowds and Party, which I think is really, really interesting, and that's more focused on, like, the nature of organizing and the sort of limits of, like, movement politics as opposed to, like, party organization. I believe she's in the PSL, which is the Party for Socialism and Liberation. So, I mean, you can take it with a grain of salt, depending on how you view that particular organization. She has a new book out that I've been really excited to read, but I haven't gotten a chance to yet, called Comrade, which is about the difference between building solidarity and, like, the sort of alienating experience that can come from certain leftist circles and things, I think with a particular focus on, like, online stuff. So that's kind of more what I've been reading. Besides that, I have, like, a shitload of books about fascism that I've been reading. I don't know if those are very instructive to the good elements of it, but I've mentioned this, I think, to you guys. I don't think I've said it on the show, so I'll say it again. To understand the contemporary alt-right, best book I've read is Neo-Reaction: A Basilisk by Elizabeth Sandifer.
Oh, that's so good.
It's more of like a sort of literary, philosophical kind of approach, but it's really interesting. And then there's David Neuert's Alt-America, which gives you more of like a kind of broader historical approach to looking at that. So if you really want to depress yourself, I got a ton more books about Nazis and fascists and everything in between there.
I am by far not as learned as Shane is, but I will recommend, and I do highly recommend this because it's an excellent primer on the subject, is Understanding Marxism by Richard Wolff, part of the Democracy at Work new canon of books. So yeah, Understanding Marxism by Richard Wolff. It's a short read. I think I read it in like 2 hours or something, and it's absolutely outstanding to like give you an understanding of how this economy really works. Like, you know, this is something I was, you know, arguing with somebody on Twitter today, because that's how I spend my, you know, waking moments of this timely on this earthly plane. And somebody said like, oh, you know, you say you don't like Bill Gates, but you're using a computer. I was like, you know, workers build computers. Bill Gates does not build computers. So it's just stuff like that, just like little things that have informed me of how this political economy actually works. It was extremely helpful, and I highly, highly recommend it.
You know, interesting to that point, a little tidbit, because I've been doing some looking into like late stage Soviet stuff recently for a project I've been doing. That you know, the whole idea that like you were just saying that, you know, computers are uniquely capitalist invention, whatever. Obviously, just like untrue. Like developed equally in the Soviet bloc during the time of the Cold War, and Soviet computing attempted ternary computing as opposed to binary computing. Basically, like a three unit thing. So the whole idea too that binary is like some essential truth or some essential, like the only way to do it, you know, maybe we could complicate that a little bit. I don't know if the computers worked, so I'm not,
you know what else?
it could be that binary really is the only way to do it.
You know what else came out of Soviet Russia?
Bernie Sanders,
the theremin.
Yo.
Well, also Bernie, but the theremin, a very impressive work of computing and music.
Hell yeah.
I have a big book on the theremin guy that we bought together, actually, Gary. And that is going to probably end up being a summer read. I'm going to read about
our magical theremin trip.
Are you, Carrie, are you familiar with Clara Rockmore?
Mm-mm.
She was a really interesting character. She was a theremin player from a long time ago. She was Lithuanian, born in like the early part of the century. But there's a haunting, absolutely haunting rendition that she does of Tchaikovsky's Valse Sentimentale that I highly recommend.
Oh, I just looked her up. We definitely saw her when we went to the theremin museum.
Definitely, yeah. No,
like they definitely had like a video of her.
Yeah, she was definitely like a pioneer of the art, and she played, you know, she transposed a lot of classical pieces to play them on the theremin. And I think she had a relationship with Mr. Theremin, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, Leon Theremin.
Yeah, wasn't she like trained by him or something, Shane? Remember? We like...
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, she was with Leon context, Theremin.
We went to the Theremin Museum and the Moog Museum when we were
But this is actually a really good story, because we didn't know we were in Theremin Town, remember?
Yeah.
You were like independently telling me about the Theremin before we got in an Uber, because we had watched like Mars Attacks. That's, and then when we got in the Uber, we were talking about the theremin, and the guy was like, you know, the Moog factory is here, right?
Wow.
And we were like, what?
Wow.
And that's like where all the theremins are made, and the theremin museum is in the town that we were in. It was just like totally a coincidence.
Fucking
we didn't
awesome.
Even know.
We spent a
it
whole
was
day
so cool.
Just playing with theremins.
It's awesome. If I'm you can do it, do it.
Yeah, it is now one of the ambitions of my life to get a theremin, to be able to have some approximation of playing it. It's surprisingly really difficult.
It's so hard.
But yeah. it looks and sounds fucking awesome. I mean, I like again, to circle back to the music question, what I like about the theremin is it just sounds unnatural and scary, and it doesn't really have any like tone or rhythm to it. And it's just kind of this like all, you know, like awe-inspiring industrial drone that kind of fills the air with noise.
I think I've seen Les Claypool play a theremin. I've definitely seen a theremin live. I think I might have seen Mike Gordon from Fish play one as well in concert.
I wouldn't doubt that.
It's just like a sound that you immediately associate with like something terrifying and eerie.
I immediately associate it with science fiction.
Yeah.
There's a picture of Lenin playing the
no
theremin.
No way.
The theremin was presented to him in the 20s because it was developed in Soviet Union. And Lenin was like,
oh,
totally blown away. And for him, he was like, this is socialism. Like, this is socialist science. Because, you know, it does appear like even to this day, you know, it's 100 years old. And there's all kinds of new electronic doodads and music makers and noise makers and synthesizers and stuff. But it still is like, it's like magic. It's like,
it's really just like a
fucking radio antenna, and you just wave your hands in front of it and it generates like tones and noises. And it's incredible. And,
it really feels like magic.
It's great. I mean, then he had a stroke and he died. So I don't know. I'm not drawing a connection between the two things. I'm just saying.
The theremin killed Lennon. We're just saying. Do not play theremin, you'll die. That's what we're saying.
I'm trying to think which Tom Waits song had a theremin in it. Maybe there wasn't. Maybe I'm just mistaken.
I know what's going at the end of this fucking episode.
Oh, we should. Oh, we haven't closed with
the Mars Attack soundtrack.
Oh, hell yeah.
No.
Hell yeah.
We haven't closed with a Tom Waits song yet.
I have tried to convince Cari to allow me to play the Mars Attacks theme at our wedding when we walk out of the room.
And can you elaborate on the whole thing that you want us to do?
Well, I thought what would be cool. So if you recall from the film, the Mars Attacks standard issue soldier uniform is like a green kind of unisex like jumper with little highlights around like, you know, the joints and stuff, and then like a giant helmet. But for the Martian ambassador and for the Martian emperor, they wear these elaborate, like, I don't know, tinfoil fluorescent coats.
Yeah. You know, like these
huge, like, fucking capes. And I thought it would be so cool. So the ambassador and the emperor, one is purple and one is red. And I thought that would be a really cool way to walk out, you know, at the height of the song. And just like brum, 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 and like the marching and the drums, and we walk slowly out, right, in these giant fucking draped capes, and then on a screen I thought that we could be walking towards, because obviously we're not going to have like a religious component to the ceremony, I thought we could walk towards a screen of like the earth, you know, like just like a spinning globe, and just like approach it and then ultimately conquer it with our love.
Just do a... Can you do a Patreon poll to see if we should do this or not?
Yeah, we'll do an internal Patreon poll. If you think what I just said is a really good idea, please vote. If you think it's not a good idea, like, why... Stop listening.
If you think I should wear a pretty white dress at my wedding, then you know what to do.
I would say yes to the dress. And by dress, I mean a long, elaborate purple tinfoil cape.
Shane, I thought you were going to say it's going to be like, the leader of ceremony is going to be like, and Shane, do you take Cari to be your lawfully wedded wife? And you just go, gack, 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 gack.
I am your friend.
Also, the person officiating will be wearing a Batman costume, so just add that to the mix. That's true. It's 100% true.
Yeah, Shane's going to be in the Mars Attacks in the alien outfit, and then also just bizarrely at the same time wearing Joker makeup.
You want to know how I got these Mars?
Oh, come on. But before we change the subject too far away from books and literature and stuff, I just wanted to add real quick that Red Dead Redemption 2 is it's actually very very helpful illustration of some out of unemployed workers, you know, living on the fringes of society in a moderately, you know, rapidly industrializing society, you know, and attempting to make their living by expropriating the wealth of wealthy industrialists like Leviticus Cornwall. So I think that's very illustrative of class struggle. Also, really drives home the need for Medicare for All with Arthur Morgan's tragic death from tuberculosis. So check out Red Dead Redemption 2. That's my recommendation.
Very important.
Seminal.
The great American novel. Yeah.
I played the multiplayer one online with Shane very briefly, and we just got like murdered over and over.
Hell yeah.
It wasn't fun.
That didn't happen. I was doing good, I was.
We got drowned a lot. This guy kept drowning.
That's not what happened. No.
Yeah.
Misrepresenting. Yeah. The connection was really bad in the house. It was not...
The guy was cheating.
It was not to the level that you need to be in order to play... You know, online.
The game was cheating, and there was also lag.
Yeah.
It was a lot of lag.
Your controller was broken.
I kept dropping from the fucking server.
Pete Buttigieg was losing, and he jumped up and unplugged the console.
And then said that he won.
Buttigieg absolutely would be. Buttigieg would be the kind of kid that like invites you over to like to play, you know, Nintendo or whatever. Invites you over to his house, and then like he only wants to play a single player game. And then like every time, like you're like, okay, can I have a turn now? He's like, no. I died too quick. I gotta get another life.
Yeah, dude.
And you just never get the controller.
I hate that kid.
Yeah, that's Mayor Pete right there.
That's the worst kind of kid.
Pete Buttigieg is absolutely the kind of kid. Remember, like, in elementary school when you'd like have like a math assignment or something in class, right? And then the teacher would be going down the list of the answers, and there'd be that one kid that would go like, yes, 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 like every time they get one right. That's Pete Buttigieg.
That's it.
That's really good.
I also thought he's like the guy, the kid that like gets left in charge of the other kids when the teacher leaves the room. Yeah. That's him.
He's a fascist.
I want to just, again, one last book I would like to recommend, because I just recently bought this for one of our friends, Adam, and I got a new copy for myself. I sometimes end up giving my books away when I invite people over because I have a lot of them. But so I got another copy of this because it's been about 10 years since I've read it. But Confronting Collapse, The Crisis of Energy and Money in a Post-Peak Oil World by Michael C. Rupert. If you're interested in peak oil and how energy kind of informs our lives, he's not necessarily a leftist, but he is very much like an environmentalist. Very interesting book. After he wrote the book, committed suicide.
No, I knew it was
coming. In big air quotes.
Oh, really?
Suicide.
Really?
I mean, it's pretty likely that he actually did kill himself, but there's a huge contingent of the peak oil community that maintains that it was likely that, like, because he originally, he was like a LAPD narcotics officer.
Oh, weird, really?
And his whole thing is like, he was like a whistleblower, and he spoke at like the hearings that were involved in like Iran-Contra, because he firsthand saw the United States government like smuggling drugs into the same neighborhoods that he was supposed to police. So he like blew the whistle on that.
Oh. Wow.
I don't know how much of this is true, but he claimed like, you know, all these people in his life like turn out to be like CIA and he
Wait,
was like
what's
hunted
his name?
Down,
what's
including,
his name?
Including the woman who he was like romantically involved with.
Wait, what,
like tried
wait,
to kill
yeah,
him
what's
or
his
something.
Name?
What's
I
his
know
guy's
this
name?
Michael C. Rupert.
That's not who I'm thinking of.
He had a long-standing like newsletter. I'm trying to remember the name of it. I think it was called like The 100th Monkey. He's a very eclectic guy. Well, the 100th monkey idea is like, I don't know if this is like true or apocryphal, but the story he tells is that like in the Cold War in like the 50s, the United States government did this like test on some island in the South Pacific where they were, you know, blowing up the fucking beautiful foliage with atom bombs. And they did this test where they like reintroduced a bunch of like monkeys onto an island to like see how they would interact with like living on a radiated island. And they taught a couple of the monkeys to like wash the coconuts in water before they ate them. And so the idea is that like, you know, they would go back and see like if the monkeys were teaching each other to do this. And, you know, like after a week, you know, it would go from like 4 monkeys to like 10 monkeys. Then it would go to like maybe like 10 to like 15. It was like slow growth. But once it was like the 100th monkey learned how to do that, like the next week, all of the monkeys on the island knew how to do that. So his contention was like that with the peak oil stuff, like he's searching for the 100th monkey. You know what I mean? Like he's searching for the new person who's going to like enter the community of knowledge. And then suddenly like everybody's going to become aware of it. Very eclectic
That's
guy.
That's you, dude.
This is what this is what the great thinker Malcolm Gladwell would refer to as the tipping point.
Oh my god.
You got to find that Maven monkey.
All right, guys, we should wrap it up.
All right.
I want to watch the debate.
Yeah, I want to watch Sanders just fucking body this goofy, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think one way we can maybe end really quick, because I know, you know, again, since Cari, you know, thank you for coming on and talking with us about your experiences there, and particularly about getting over that hurdle of, like, kind of getting involved and doing something. And I know, like, Dwight and Chris, you guys have been doing, like, the texting thing for Bernie as well, mm-hmm. and I know, Cari, you were talking about doing that, and how easy it was, you know?
So easy.
Yeah. And I think, because there's a lot of people online, you know, especially in the spaces that we hang out with, that like, you know, there can be a creep of nihilism, like, oh, nothing can get done or whatever. But as you, you know, the phrase you used earlier, Dwight, that I think was really good is the barrier to entry for these things is actually pretty low. Like, it's really mm-hmm. easy to, like, get involved. And once you go over that first hurdle of kind of making that move, it's really easy to do. I mean, I know myself, I've been texting for Bloomberg now for a couple and after the first 10 of getting told I was a fucking idiot, I was a moron, I was a sellout, etc., it became easier and easier to do.
And you're getting paid so handsomely to do it.
Oh man,
it's worth it.
Oh man,
it's good, huh?
It's all going into the Vegas fund, baby. Me and Chris, we're gonna drive out there. in like a brand new convertible and drive back.
It's like,
and like,
it's like fucking... Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Yeah, I'm ready for it.
No, but the texting really is so easy. Like, if you have 30 minutes free in your day, you can do the texting. If you have a couple hours free on the weekend to walk around, you can canvas and knock on, like, you know, 20 to 30 doors or something. And it all makes a difference, I think. Like, I definitely gave information to a lot of people that didn't have it about where they needed to vote and stuff. So it makes a tangible difference.
Hell yeah.
We're going to win. We're going to win, folks.
I'm feeling pretty positive.
Yeah, I'm feeling honest, out, feeling, I'm feeling a rare moment of optimism.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Same.
Cari, I'm so pleased that you're out there doing the good work. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for telling us about your experience there.
Thank you for having me.
Hell yeah.
And thanks again to the Patreon listeners, you know, who are listening to this show, this episode, because they're supporting the show and everything. And I just want to let you guys know, you guys are basically the 100th monkeys, right? Because, like, once you guys start listening to the show, you know what I'm saying? Like, everybody's going to be listening to it.
That's right.
So, yeah, so in
Peak Oil, look it up. Google Peak Oil.
In addition to the internal Patreon poll that we're going to do about Shane and Carrie's wedding, we're going to do an additional poll to the patrons about, you know, what am I doing with my chunk of the Patreon money? Is it all going on red, or is it all going on black?
In fact, you can bet a log at home for a small fee that goes to Chris's.
Are red and black, are those the new Juul flavors?
I just imagine like a live stream of Chris at like a slot machine, and it's just like the phone is just like sitting on his chest. It's just all you see is like the slot machine and part of his arm as he like pushes the buttons, and you just hear him mutter like every 30 seconds, like, "Come on, man." It's just like 4 hours. Of just like, oh, fuck.
I wish you guys were here at the Wild Wild West Casino. Oh, we could all go lose $500 right now. That'd be great.
We'll get some In-N-Out Burger.
I gotta have $500 first.
Yeah. Gotta get more Patreon subscribers, man.
That's right.
Stay cool, folks.
Stay cool and cue whichever Tom Waits song we want to listen to.
No, just arrhythmic theremin tones. Yes, that's my demand.
That's
just the shittiest theremin.
We'll get one of the videos that we took at the Moog Factory.
Yeah,
where we're like playing it really badly and weirdly. Yeah.
Stay cool, folks.
Take care.
Stay cool.
In the wall, and we'll slaughter them all.